Hey there. Hello, my name is Keith McNally, and I wrote a book about The Last of Us. So this is going to be like an audiobook version of it. I'm going to put this out as a podcast and also as videos on YouTube that have tons of cool clips and still images and shit edited in. Unfortunately, I don't have video of my actual playthrough, so I'm going to take, you know, just stills and stuff. I'll credit where I grabbed them from, but I think it's going to be really cool. So if you're listening to this as a podcast and you want to check out the video version, that'll be on YouTube. It's basically a playthrough I did of The Last of Us without picking up any items. The actual book is called The Last of Us Surviving the Super Apocalypse, because the idea is I kind of wanted to recreate the stress I had the first time I played The Last of Us, so I didn't pick up any items. And, I don't know, surviving the super apocalypse is like a silly name. It's like the apocalypse is so bad that there's not even any items to pick up. It's the super apocalypse. I just thought it was kind of like a semi-corny name that might stick in people's heads. But in hindsight, I actually think it might be a bad name for the book. I don't know. And the book itself doesn't have very much of an introduction. The book, it has a lot of tangents and side stuff and just a lot of weird thoughts I had about video games in general, but I kind of wanted to get to the actual start of the game relatively quickly, so I had a big introduction that I wrote that I cut from the book because it just wasn't working out. But for this audio version, I think I will just record a little introduction to just to tell you who I am, tell you where I'm coming from with this here book. So, The Last of Us had just come out. I started writing this book in, like, 2014. Took a long time to finish, but The Last of Us blew my mind in so many fucking ways, and no one had written a book about The Last of Us yet. And as of this recording, still no one has. So that's cool. So, let me tell you why I decided to write a book about The Last of Us. I'll just tell you a bit about my history, my video game history. Because, I mean, I guess it sounds obvious, you know, it's The Last of Us. It won every Game of the Year award you could ever fucking win. It just, the year 2013 was The Last of Us year, you know? Just a crazy, excellent game. But I'll get into a little more detail. So, I grew up in the 80s and, you know, right at that perfect curve of the start of video games, where I remember the first video game that we had in our house was this, did you hear that? My Canadian accent? We had this Radio Shack Pong thing that was just like two hardwired paddle controllers, and the thing could play like four variations of Pong, and my parents must have bought it before I was born. And I mean, you can't get much closer to ground level than that, you know? So it's kind of nice. It's like, I feel like I really, like video games really did grow up pretty much exactly on a curve with my generation. So when I was a little kid, I wanted a Nintendo like crazy. I wanted a Nintendo so bad. But the Christmas that my dad finally talked my mom into letting us get one, they were all sold out. So we ended up getting a Sega Master System instead. And later on, we got a Nintendo probably a year later because I have a great fondness now for the Sega Master System. But I mean, obviously, you know, you had to get a Nintendo. It'd be crazy in the 80s to not have a Nintendo. And that pattern kind of kept up. Between me and my brother, we had so many weird systems, you know? Like, we would have most of the mainline systems, but there was a couple big ones that we missed. Like, we somehow never had a Super Nintendo or a PlayStation 1, but they were always around, you know? Other kids in the neighborhood had them. So it didn't feel like we didn't have them, but somehow we didn't. But what we did have was the Master System, the Nintendo. We jumped over to Genesis, and I bought a TurboGrafx-16 from this kid that I knew. And my brother had a Game Gear and an Atari Lynx, and I eventually got a Game Boy, because that's such a weird thing, like where like the Game Boy seems so much lesser than a Game Gear and a Lynx on the surface of it, but when you've got Link's Awakening on the Game Boy, I could give a fuck about the Game Gear and the Lynx, you know? But it's still just neat to examine those weird side things. I didn't have a Saturn. Nobody did. I had a lot of friends that I made because we were like the Sega kids, you know? We were the kids that had the Sega Master System. There was like three of us and none of us bought a Saturn. I've still never to this day seen a Saturn with my own eyes. My brother bought the original Xbox. Of course, we got a PlayStation 2 eventually. This is by this time, I'd, you know, moved out of my parents' house. And my brother had a Dreamcast also. And we always had PCs at home that were like a little bit behind the curve. They were just for my parents are real estate lawyers, so they just had computers for that. They were still good enough computers that I got a pretty good PC experience, but like when Doom came out, we didn't have enough RAM to play it. I didn't get to play Doom properly for like a couple of years after it came out. But a pretty good array, a pretty good swath of video gaming going on in that house. And then by the mid-2000s, I'd moved in with my friend Matt, and we bought a PlayStation 2 because we just couldn't resist the power of Grand Theft Auto 3. And I remember, I guess, when I took a big lull with video gaming was I bought a GameCube, and I wasn't feeling those games like I used to. I never liked 3D Zelda. I just didn't work for me. I did like 3D Mario, but, you know, Sunshine, you know. So that side of things was getting a little stale for me. And the more mature side of gaming, you could say, I didn't realize this at the time. It's only looking back, but I can understand now why I felt such a lull with gaming is because as video games were progressing technologically, you know, the original games were purely, you know, all those 70s arcade games were just score stuff, just try to survive as long as you can, abstract, weird games. And a lot of the 8-bit games were similar, but, you know, it started to change, like the Capcom games and stuff, where the arcade version would be a lot different from the Nintendo version, because the Nintendo version was becoming more of a home experience, like more of an adventure to go through. And at the same time, technology improved so that more storytelling could be put into a game, and that seemed awesome back in the day, like when Ninja Gaiden would have those cutscenes, like they were fucking mind-blowing. Or like when you'd see those little CGI movies in like Warcraft 1 and 2, like every time you unlocked one, it felt so awesome, like you couldn't wait to see the next one. But then in that CD era, that weird middle era, the post-cartridge era, there was like too much of that shit. Like every game needed to have movie-style cutscenes and voice acting, and it was all very badly done and very badly integrated. Like it really was just crammed in there. Like what used to be a fun little 30-second video of a bunch of orcs setting up a ballista or something now was hours and hours of bad storytelling in an environment where it really didn't fit even. Like I always thought the idea of just cramming a storyline into a video game really never worked for me. Like, there's a lot of people that say they play video games for the story, and God bless you, I guess, but I sure as fuck don't. Like, I really don't. Even movies and TV shows, I have a very hard time, like, just like ADD kicks in or something. Like, it's so hard for me to just sit there and stare at something that isn't really engaging me. And when you combine that with a video game, it's bananas, man. It's like you're having this mechanical experience, and whatever neurons are firing in your brain about trying to mechanically dissect this game and learn how it works are interrupted by having to watch these fucking cutscenes and shit. Like, it's just brutal. It's like if you're in a playground running around and a teacher just gives you like a page and just says like, sit down right now and do these questions. Like, it doesn't matter if they're not hard questions to answer. It's an inappropriate time. It's like, are you kidding me right now? I was just having fun and now I gotta sit down and do this? Like, it really didn't work for me. But I didn't think of it as clearly back then because it's just how video games were. I mean, nowadays there's a lot more open. Like, there's Steam games, there's, you know, games that cost $1, there's games that cost $80 here in Canada. But there wasn't that array in the PlayStation 1, PlayStation 2, time. Every game was a big budget, gonna cost you $60 game, so every game needed to have cutscenes, and every game needed to have a storyline, and every game needed to have a blah 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 blah, and there's really no choice. And it was just wearing me down. Like, I never wanted to be one of those guys that skipped cutscenes. I used to think that was crazy, but I was getting there. I'm like, I don't know what else to do, man. I can't sit here and listen to this anymore. I can't do it. I don't care about this shit. But at the same time, the inclusion of that level of storytelling, it really fucked up video games, because that became the main point. Like, back in the day, you didn't expect to be able to beat a video game. Like, when we first got that Sega Master System, I remember my dad made this deal with me and my brother. He's like, every time you guys beat a game, show me the ending and I'll buy you a new game. And we were like, great, that sounds like a great deal. Let's do that. But it became clear after a while that, like, okay, here's the... We had a lot of Master System games because, you know, a lot of that stuff was discounted and you could get the games really cheap. So say I had a stack of 30 games. It's like, here's the 8 games we can beat. And then here are the other games that we will never beat. Never. I still can't. To this day, like, there's like Thunderblade on the Master System. I downloaded a ROM of it once and I used save states like a maniac to beat that game. But even as an adult, I can't do it without that, you know? I just can't. But that was fine. Like, again, you weren't... If you beat a game, it was a treat. You weren't expected to beat it. But once storytelling became a primary, if not the primary, focus of games, it just changed fundamentally how video games are constructed. Because people began to expect to be able to beat a game. And they'd be upset if they couldn't beat a game because, hey, I bought this game for $60. I want to see the story. I want to see the ending. It's not okay if I don't. So you got, you know, difficulty settings that couldn't possibly be too easy, you know? And just the way games were designed began to change. I've got this pet theory because people love Zelda Ocarina of Time for the Nintendo 64. You know, like, it's a huge... A lot of people say it's their favorite game. I think the reason it sticks in my craw so much is just because people talk it up so much, you know? It's just like... It's not a bad game. It's like a B+, it's a B, whatever, it's okay. But as a 3D Zelda goes, it really, I didn't like it nearly as much as the old 2D Zeldas. Controversial opinion, I know, but it's true. Like, when A Link Between Worlds finally came out for the 3DS, it was like the scales fell from my eyes. I was like, after all these years, I'm like, oh shit, I do like Zelda. I could have swore I liked Zelda, and I do. I like this kind of Zelda. I don't like 3D Zelda, it just... Really hand-holdy, really boring, really straightforward. But I feel like the generation that came after me loves that game so much because they're coming at games from a different perspective. Like, if you ever see a teenager from today play an old-school video game, it's just pathetic. They just get destroyed. Like, they're like tigers that don't know how to fight. Like they don't know... to fight back. It's the weirdest thing. Whereas, like, I really, that kind of no jump button and Navi telling you all the shit, I did not get along with that idea at all. So, I ended up giving up video games for a while because around that time I was also just hadn't left my hometown, spinning my wheels a little. I was like, gotta go do some adventuring. I'm from the East Coast of Canada. So I moved to Vancouver for a while, I moved to New York for a while. I really fell out of touch with the video games. I just played, you know, what was around. If somebody had a system, like, oh, cool, you've got Mario Galaxy, right on. You know, I'll play it for the one evening that I'm at somebody's house or whatever. I still liked video games, but they weren't as much a part of my life. And yeah, I guess that was the weird thing, is I really felt like I didn't even miss them, really. Because what was I going back to? Just a lot of cutscenes and a lot of drab... shit that I didn't want to do, you know, like somehow video games and me had gone in different ways, and it was so weird because I loved them so much when I was a kid. But then slowly I came back, and I came back really because of podcasting. I found that show Retronauts, and I loved it because they were talking about old video games and all the games that I loved and remembered, and it was such a neat idea where obviously me and my friends all loved video games growing up. But podcasting was such a neat medium. This was around 2008 or so that I found Retronauts. And it, you know, it's podcasting is everywhere now, but it was kind of novel back then. And it's this idea of like, holy shit, it's like a radio show where they're talking about Bionic Commando. Like, holy fuck, you know, this is amazing. This is great. I couldn't get enough of it. So I listened to all of those, and then I'm like, well, you know what? Even though I don't know on the other video game podcasts that are talking about modern games, I don't really know what they're talking about, but let's try them out. And that's when I started to realize like how deep into like my soul video games were, because when I would hear these people like GFW Radio, a lot of those one-up shows back then, they were really great shit. Just hearing people talk about even other topics, like even if they weren't talking about video games, they were just talking about whatever. Hearing them discuss stuff through the filter of video games, like I felt this huge kinship. And it's like, oh shit, yeah, like we're all from the same place. We all have this love of video games, even if they're different kinds of video games. Like even if you were a pure PC guy that just played a shit ton of Populous and Civilization, or just a Nintendo guy who just played Mega Man, whatever. There's something about video games that was just really, like, if I ever had a church, you know, or some worship at the altar of something, that would be it. That's the only thing. And it would just, yeah, just, man, made me so happy just to connect to that feeling again and to that kind of community. Which also seems weird because, man, the video game community nowadays is a goddamn pain in the ass. But in, like, 2008, it was new and novel, and it was like, ah, this is great. How great that we're all coming together and just demonstrating that we all gave a shit about this and this was important to us and this meant something. So when I got back into video games big time was I moved to Toronto and moved there in 2010, and by like 2011 I became roommates with this guy Craig, who, man, that dude hooked me up. It's amazing. To this day, still, I mean, like, the only guy... I played PSVR at his house a few months ago, and it's, like, so cool to be able to try this stuff. But yeah, back in 2011, so Craig had the big TV. He had PlayStation 3 and a Wii, as well as a bunch of older systems, but they were both hacked. And how beautiful is that? Because we had tons of games, and I started buying tons of games, and, you know, we didn't just pirate the shit out of stuff. But the piracy angle was so good to just be able to try things, you know? Like, if I got it in my head that I wanted to try Far Cry 2, and I couldn't find a copy anywhere, I just downloaded it and made myself happy miserable by playing Far Cry 2 on the hardest difficulty. And on console, you can't save that game at any time, and oh, man, brutal. Or Demon's Souls. Demon's Souls is so cool. Like, it's such an important piece of the Dark Souls saga, and it's so hard to get and so hard to play, and I just loved that I could just download it, and like, boom, the first time I ever got invaded in Demon's Souls, like, I'll never forget. It's so cool. So God bless Craig and his sweet hacked hardware and huge library of just games that he had bought. I don't know why I'm bringing up the... People get so uptight about piracy. I really don't feel that way. And, oh man, it was just great. Like, I spent so much time when he'd be at work and I'd just be at home playing video games. Man, just the greatest. And I lived with him for, like, 3 years, I guess. And man, I caught up big time. Man, I played a lot of video games. And in a lot of ways, I'd say those are the two big components of this book, where when I get off on side tangents about things that aren't The Last of Us, there's either the old school retro stuff of like, hey, remember this game or whatever? But then there's also all that stuff I played at Craig's place. Like, I did a lot of catching up and learning about shit and becoming reacquainted with video games, and it was a good fucking time. And it was when I really started to put together these theories about what I like in a video game. My friend Matt had started to convince me that I should be playing games on hard, which this book will get into that. I've got a lot of thoughts, theories about video game difficulty. And at first, you know, I hesitated because it's a scary concept in a weird way, even though it's just a video game. But it's like when you play Resident Evil 1 and like you're scared to die. There's no reason to be scared to die. It's just a video game, but you just feel nervous, you know? Like, that's how I felt about playing games on hard, because I was like just thinking, like, what if I can't do it? What if Matt's better at video games than me? What if I just suck? But as I finally got up the courage to put games on harder difficulties, I really started to realize that it's not about that. Like, depends on the game, but generally putting a game on hard in this day and age when games are relatively complex, it's not about the game just purely getting tougher, and it's not about the just banging your head against it. it's about having to approach a game in a new way. Like, if you can't just find an easy tactic and cheese your way through a game anymore, you really need to learn what that game is and what that game is offering, how the mechanics work and how the systems work. And it really, once I started doing it, I was like, I'm never looking back. This is great. There's occasional times when playing a game on a hard difficulty will just make you miserable, but I always try it now. I at least go in that way. And most of the time, I have a way better time. And the monotonous storytelling of video games hasn't changed much. I mean, there are examples of games that tell stories in weird, unique ways. Like, I mean, obviously Dark Souls is the big modern example of like a weird way to tell a story that only a video game could really do. But occasionally, I don't know, I wouldn't say the level of writing and production in video games has risen very much. In fact, I might have even liked it better in some ways back in those PS2 GameCube days, because at least it was quaint in a way. Now, I don't know, it's as tiresome as ever to me. My tolerance for sort of straight-ahead, movie-style, cutscene-based, dialogue-based storytelling has not improved, really. I still find that stuff, most of the time, pretty tough. Pretty tough to get through, not very good. And I think it was one of those cases where people were always just like, okay, yeah, writing a video game sucks, but we'll get better at it. And as the years keep going by, it's like, well, how come we're not getting better at it? How come nothing is changing? And I think slowly people are starting to recognize that with stuff like Dark Souls or with like the environmental storytelling of BioShock or something, that there are other ways for a video game to tell a story that are more appropriate to the medium, and we just have to learn what those are. But cramming in cutscenes and shit, it didn't work then, it doesn't work now, it's not going to work in the future. It would be nice if the cutscenes were of pristine quality, then it would be acceptable, but they're not. They never are. You know, even quote-unquote good games, like if you go back through a list of games that won best story throughout the years, it's a really sad list, man. It's really awful. But the mechanical side of games was still super interesting to me, and like cranking a game up to hard brought back those old memories of what it felt like to play a game when I was a kid. But at the same time, games are more open now, so it wasn't just, I'm just going to get stuck and I'll never be able to beat this game. Now it's like both feelings. It's like, I will be able to beat this game, but I'm going to have to really think my way through this and figure out how I'm going to do this. And I love it. I love video games again. So with The Last of Us, obviously the Uncharted games are pretty famous, and I liked them a lot. The first three, I found Uncharted 4 incredibly boring, but we'll get to that. And it was clear that Naughty Dog was doing a way better job than everyone else as far as performances and integrating a movie-like experience into a game. Those guys were definitely ahead of the curve. And The Last of Us, like, just, man, I never expected. I knew The Last of Us would be cool. I was just, hey, it's a Naughty Dog game. Like, I'll go buy it day one. I'm in. But I didn't expect it to be as good as it is. Like, as far as putting in cutscenes and just delivering a story, delivering a movie-style story into a video game, they did a great job. Like, about as good of a job as you could do. And if that's all they had done, it still would have been really impressive. Like, holy shit, that game did a great job. But what really amazed me about The Last of Us and why I decided to write a book about it, like the pure plot of The Last of Us, I wouldn't have been able to write a whole book about it. It's just not quite enough. It's pretty great, but it's not enough for me to really sink my teeth into for 2 fucking years or whatever, you know, to sit down and write a whole book about. But cranking that game up to hard and then Survivor. And at the time I wrote this book, Grounded didn't exist, but so I kind of made up my own extra hard with the picking up no items thing. I was so amazed at how you take this story that's already really great, purely from a movie perspective of like a well, purely from like a movie style perspective of great cutscenes, like they did a great job, and then the weird aspect of video game storytelling of like we're spending so much downtime with these characters and just watching them walk around and talk to each other and just examine this destroyed world, that's something you couldn't do in a movie or a TV show without it being crazy boring. But in a game, it's super compelling. Like, I love that half of The Last of Us isn't combat-based. It's just exploring, and it's so great, and it works so well. But then also, when you crank that game up to higher difficulties, that's, to me, the cherry on top. That's what ties it all together. And that's what makes it this really, really visceral experience, which it's like a bit of a catch-22, because it's kind of not fun, you know? Nowadays, playing The Last of Us on hard doesn't seem like that big a deal. There's so many higher difficulties than that. But the first time through, I had a very hard time. I had a lot of times when I would get stuck on a fight for a long time and have to sleep on it and come back the next day and then another. And then when I'd finally get through, you'd hear more raiders just around the next bend, and you're like, oh god damn it, I gotta do this again. And just never having resources and always feeling starved for stuff. And by the time I got to the end of that game, I felt a kinship with Joel that I could never have felt if it were a movie or even a novel. The way he was just worn out by this world, the way he just didn't have any reason to believe in his fellow man. Like, why would I care about these other people when all they do is ruin my life and make my life miserable, and you can't trust anyone and everyone is just out to destroy you? And I was like, buddy, I am there with you, dude. Because I went through that too. These guys have been fucking with me this whole time. It's been brutal. And when you tie all those things together, man, like, to me, that's what makes The Last of Us this game that, I don't know, it's going to be very tough for people to meet that. I mean, it's been years now since that game came out, and nothing even remotely close to it has come out as far as tying up these different types of storytelling that a video game can do. And even just the fact that mechanically, it is such a throwback to the old school. Like, it is video gamey, you know? It's not necessarily realistic. It's like, how come I have to pick up this special piece of cloth and I can't use a curtain, you know? It's like, no reason, it's a video game. But it takes, to me, from all these eras and all this span of video games, and it just comes together in such a great package, and it's like, holy fuck, what a good game, holy shit. So, that's the intro. That is what this book is about and why I decided to write it. Should mention too, I'm sure you've noticed various bird noises and maybe waves and water. It's because I tried to start recording this book and, like, you know, they've got like sound booths at the library you can go into and they're all soundproofed. Just feels stale and stiff. It felt awkward. And it's a little tough to read a book, like to read something you've written and to have it sound natural. I'm not good at that. Hopefully I'll get good at it as I go. But it didn't feel comfortable. So instead I found a beach here in Vancouver, British Columbia, where nobody's around. But that means there's going to be nature sounds in this recording. So I hope that's okay. Maybe it'll be pleasant. It's very pleasant for me. It feels a lot better to be out here. Outdoors. So yeah, like I said, the book is called The Last of Us Surviving the Super Apocalypse. You can get a copy on Amazon or whatever, but also if you'd just like to try it out, my website is keithcourage.com, like the TurboGrafx game, and you can just get a free copy there, because fuck it. And that's one thing I learned with this particular project is I was like, I did it. Finally, after all this time, I did it, man. I wrote a whole book. Holy shit. Like, the final step is done. Here's the book. Boom. And what I realized is what I had thought was the final step, because I had never gotten there before, is actually the first step. Like, okay, this book's done. Now what? You know, now how do I tell people about it? How do I promote it? How do I let people know this is a thing that exists? And it is funny to realize, like, after all this time of toiling away, I'd never actually gotten to step one before. Like, how fucking weird is that? So, yeah, this is the plan, is to now try to spread the word. So if you like this, please let people know. This is going to be a long series. It's going to take me a long time to do this, and since I don't have footage of my actual playthrough of the game, because I didn't realize at the time that I was gonna someday make a YouTube video of this, I just figured, you know, I'll just find whatever footage of people playing The Last of Us, even though, you know, none of it really fits because my playthrough has minimal equipment and everybody else's has way more. But one thing I found that I think I'm probably going to use quite a bit for the footage is good old Freako, your friend and mine Freako. Man, this guy's YouTube page is fucking amazing. He basically got a debug kit and like, I don't know, I don't really know how it works, but you know, he mods The Last of Us. He gets in there and fucks with it and finds out how to do weird shit. And it's a fascinating YouTube page. I really do think it's worth going just digging through and just seeing all the weird stuff that he does. So I'm just going to use a lot of his footage. So if you see something just bizarre happening, you know, just like people in the wrong parts of the game and just weird shit going on that can't possibly happen in The Last of Us, it's all from Freako's channel. He's fucking awesome. So yeah, if you're confused by the visuals, that's why, because it's his wacky shit, and I definitely recommend checking it out, because it's very fascinating. So without further ado, let's switch from rambly introductory talk to hopefully not overly stiff book reading. The Last of Us, Surviving the Superapocalypse by Keith McNally. What if the cordyceps pandemic was so severe that there were no weapons or items left for Joel to pick up? Author Keith McNally uses this bizarrely difficult playthrough to discuss the mechanics and storytelling of 2013's The Last of Us. This is going to take me a little time to get comfortable with. Reading is hard. The cover. My buddy Joel made the cover for this book. Playing The Last of Us must have seemed weird to him. What with all the characters saying his name all the time. Joel is a graphic design wizard, so if you'd like to pitch him some work, you can contact him at info@squidpod.com. Spoilers! This book is obviously full of Last of Us spoilers. Tess dies! Marlene dies! Fuck! It's all spoiled! But I'm also going to spoil any other game that I want at any time with no warning whatsoever. If that fills you with anxiety, then I guess you better get the fuck out of here. If someone has an early copy of a game, then of course they should keep plot details to themselves. But once a game is in general release, all bets are off. People who crow about spoilers make me want to barf into some other barf, then eat the resulting mega barf so that I double barf. To me, one of the most interesting and instructive things about art is to discuss its meaning. It frustrates me to see those kinds of discussions constantly curtailed for fear of spoilers. And let's be clear. When game nerds talk about spoilers, all they're really interested in is the body count. Who lives and who dies is not the point of a story. If a single sentence can ruin your experience with a game, then you're really not approaching art in the right way. That's a judgment call, and I'm making it. So in summary, if you've ever complained about spoilers for an older game, then take a fucking hike, Dickie. Also, best wishes. See, that is generally what I believe, but surely I could have said it in a nicer way. So angry. There are a lot of waves whenever a boat goes by. They are a little loud, but I hope that's okay. Maybe it'll be nice. Maybe it's soothing. It soothes me, that's for sure. Maybe that's the problem, is when I wrote this book, I wasn't sitting on a beautiful beach looking at mountains. I was mostly in coffee shops in Toronto. Maybe this will be the sidetrack of this whole making this audiobook is periodically psychoanalyzing myself. Oh, and here comes a train. Wait for that to go by. Let's pretend we're in the train level of Uncharted 2. Still to this day, the greatest Uncharted moment. All right. Positive spoilers. Still talking about spoilers. I've actually become kind of a fan of spoilers. We truly do live in a media flood, There are more games, movies, TV shows, books, and comics than we could ever hope to absorb in 100 lifetimes. 300 hours of video are uploaded to YouTube every minute, a statistic which is already out of date. The riverbanks have eroded, and the flood is not going to stop until our whole society outright collapses. So when someone says, "You should play this game, but I can't tell you anything about it," chances are I'm not going to play it. I am drowning in art, and I don't know if you're throwing me a life raft or a rock. I need more information. I recently played Her Story and Brothers: A Tale of Two Sons, both after listening to spoiler discussions about them. I was intrigued by what I'd heard, and knowing some of the plot details did not meaningfully detract from those games. More importantly, those discussions helped guide me toward ever playing those games at all. I know the spoiler guard think they're justified in their constant censorship of game discussions, but I think they have way overplayed their hand. At this point, they're basically just annoying shits. And here I note that I had no editorial guidance while writing this book, and that it feels good. So yeah, I mean, again, I could say that less bombastically, but I do think that's generally true. I mean, for instance, in the cases of Her Story and Brothers, yeah, it would have been better if I could have gone in completely blind and just known nothing about them, but I wouldn't have. Like, there's just too much out there. There is just a fucking ocean of stuff. And I really think getting spoiled is a small price to pay to guide you toward things that are worthwhile. In those cases, Her Story, you know, whatever, it's middling, but Brothers: A Tale of Two Sons is so great. What a great game. And it is, it's just everywhere. I feel like worrying about spoilers and people having to tag things about spoilers. I mean, ultimately, now that I'm finished this book and I know what's in it, there's very few spoilers for anything in here. I guess I just felt like I needed to get that out. I'm just so fucking sick of hearing people whine about spoilers. I just can't fucking take it anymore. It's too much. It's just, that's the world we're in. You can communicate to anyone magically on the earth at any time. You're gonna get spoiled. So fucking get over it. You know what? I'm back on the side of the version of me who wrote this book. Get over it, Dickie, or get the fuck out. All right. There we go. See, this really is like therapy. It's like the two halves of my fucking, I don't know, whatever. Okay, next section. Difficulty. Maybe reading this book will get you in the mood to replay The Last of Us. You could do a play-along. But if you've never played the game on at least hard difficulty, you gotta try it. And also, turn off listen mode. I know these ideas sound distressing at first, but they're absolutely worthwhile. The different difficulty settings in The Last of Us make a huge difference to the story being presented. The integration of story and gameplay is one of the most impressive things about The Last of Us, and that's lost when your inventory is flooded with items. Normal mode is much too forgiving, and it really takes the edge off of Joel and Ellie's struggle. I'll get deeper into my theories about game difficulty later on, but for now, just trust me. You won't need the excessive amount of items that normal mode throws at you. I'm gonna beat this whole game without picking up any items at all, for Christ's sake, so believe me. You got this. Question. You gotta do what? Answer. You gotta believe. Grounded mode. The playthrough discussed in this book was done on the PlayStation 3 on Survivor difficulty. This book took me so long to write that grounded difficulty didn't exist when I started, and thank Christ it didn't. Not picking up items on Survivor was insane enough. If I tried to do it on grounded mode, I'd probably still be trying. Afterward, I did a grounded playthrough on my friend's PlayStation 4. And whoo, doggy! Grounded mode is no joke. I did notice a few new things while I was getting my head continually blown apart, so I've included occasional grounded mode sidebars to discuss the game under that psychotic level of difficulty. Note that grounded mode is still easier to complete than Drake's Fortune is on crushing difficulty. Because that first Uncharted game is fucking impossible. It was the only Uncharted I hadn't finished on crushing until Uncharted 4. But we'll get into this later, but I didn't finish Uncharted 4 because I hated it. It was so fucking boring. I got to chapter 17. I remember, oh man, let me just take a little moment here where, I mean, I loved the Uncharted games. That's why I was there day one for The Last of Us, was because of Uncharted. And I didn't play Uncharted 4 right away, because I've been traveling around a lot. Don't have my own TV even, let alone video game system. I've just been playing all my games on laptops. So I was house-sitting for my friend Matt, and he had a PlayStation 4 and a big TV, and I borrowed Uncharted 4 from my friend Mike, and it couldn't be more perfect. Like, I had nothing to do for 3 or 4 days except just play Uncharted. And I remember by, like, chapter 4, I was texting Mike, and I was like, dude, this game is so fucking boring. Holy shit. Which he did not agree with. He loved Uncharted 4, as most of the world did. And yeah, by the time I got to 17, I distinctly remember I was back at Mike's house, and I told him, like, I didn't finish this game. I hate this game. It's so... the spark is gone. This is so unexciting. These characters are so boring. Sam Drake is such a nobody. Like, if you changed the game script so that Sully, instead of Sam being Nathan's brother, if Sully had just said, hey, I know a guy, most of that game could be the same. And the pacing was so fucking terrible and slow and long. It is so different from Uncharted 2 and 3. So different. And I feel like a lot of people really missed that. Or, I don't know, they just thought that being boring is the same as being mature. I don't know. What a piece of shit game. And I haven't played Lost Legacy yet, but I don't know. I just had to get that off my chest at the outset. Just I'm going to have like quite a few probably annoying opinions about video games as we get through this book, but I feel like Uncharted 4 is a special case because it's so closely related to The Last of Us. It's part of the Naughty Dog lineage. And it's like, I loved Uncharted 1. I loved Uncharted 2 the most, but I also loved Uncharted 3. I super loved The Last of Us. And I just wish Uncharted 4 didn't exist. I don't care about it at all. It's so bad. And, yeah, again, I don't know. Go download my book if you want to jump ahead and read my chapter on Uncharted 4. But just so you know where we're coming from, on the Naughty Dog front specifically. And, I don't know, if you love Uncharted 4, I just really... I mean, I guess it's really just the feeling you have. I felt crushing boredom. And I guess if you didn't feel that, you didn't feel that. But I really feel like... if you loved Uncharted 4, I really think it's worth going back and examining why. Like, is it just momentum? Is it just the Naughty Dog name? Are you just caught up in the fervor? Because it just makes... it's so different to me. It is so fucking different. It's such a misstep on every fucking front. Looks very pretty. But yeah, also because while writing most of this book, Uncharted 4 didn't exist. I guess this is why it's good to bring up, is when I talk about Uncharted and relate it to The Last of Us, I'm really only talking about Uncharted 1, 2, and 3. Because, yeah, it's so neat how Uncharted evolved into The Last of Us, but the way elements from The Last of Us then bled their way into Uncharted is a different story. It's all for the worse. None of it was better. Back to the book. So, I think that about covers it. Let this book begin! And if you want, you can play a drinking game where you take a shot each time I mention The Last of Us. But you will certainly die. Options. For the sake of completionism, let's start right at the beginning. Let's load this game up. Load times. Man, PlayStation 3 games take a long time to load. Navigating through all the menus is torture. In the old days, you could just slam a game in and start playing. Sega Master System games would be on a liquidation sale, when you could get them for $5 a pop. None of them were good, but you didn't care. You could have the impulse to play Phantasy Zone The Maze, and a few moments later, you were doing it. Then a few moments later, you'd be playing something else, because that game fucking sucked. The title screen. Every part of The Last of Us is so well done. Even the logo is awesome. I don't know why the title screen shows a window with cracked paint on the windowsill, but it's great. Ellie's knife is in the sill now, signifying that I've completed at least one playthrough. The window is overgrown with plants and is open a bit, its glass mostly missing. I've got no theories about what any of that means. It's just cool. But hey, at least I'm not making up theories to try to sound smart. That being said, maybe the ambiguity of the title screen does make a statement about how this game is not gonna lean on familiar tent poles. Granted, it's a zombie game about a brown-haired, bearded white guy, but the title screen is a damn window. It's the first sign that The Last of Us leans a bit more art game than your standard big-budget strangulation simulator. Maybe the title screen is the first step in preparing the player for the ending. It's a sign that decisions in this game's design are not going to be democratized. The title screen is a dang window, for Christ's sake. No committee in the world chose that. All right, let's check out these options. Difficulty, survivor, check. You can turn the gore off. Think I'll leave that on. Controls, inverted. Inverted controls. I've always played games with my vertical controls inverted. Old flight simulators may be partially to blame. They were the first three-dimensional games I played on an old monochrome PC. I internalized the idea that pushing forward makes your view tip downward. I've heard a theory that inverted controls relate to how a person perceives games. If you imagine the point of focus as being the game character themselves, you'll want pressing up to make the character look up. But if you imagine the point of focus as your actual self playing the game, then there's a fulcrum point between you and the screen, like a seesaw. So you want pressing up to tip the camera downward. Whatever it is, I can barely play games if the controls aren't inverted. My vision keeps drifting toward the ceiling, and in tense moments, I just spaz out. Invert update! Holy cow! During the time I spent writing this book, I miraculously managed to rewire my brain. After a lifetime of using inverted controls, I no longer do, and the switch was totally inadvertent. I got a new laptop, and I decided to replay Fallout New Vegas. I'd never played its DLC, and I was pretty jazzed about Fallout 4. I didn't yet know that Fallout 4 would have most of its RPG elements removed and would be boring as fuck. New Vegas was a lot of fun on a second playthrough, now that I had a sense of how that game wanted to be played. I initially tried to sequence break my way into New Vegas, and the game fought hard against me. So I thought, fine, fuck you. I'll put off going to Vegas for as long as possible. These were both miserable decisions and messed with the game's storytelling considerably. I was a lot happier on the second playthrough when me and New Vegas were both on the same page. Meanwhile, I was waiting for the world's slowest controller to arrive in the mail, and I didn't have a mouse, so I ran around the Mojave with the trackpad, my hand formed into an awkward claw. Under those bizarre conditions, playing inverted didn't seem intuitive, so I logged 100 hours of non-inverted gameplay. When I finally plugged in a controller, my sickness was cured! Through some transitive miracle, inverted controls no longer felt right to me. So, that is a weird road to walk, and maybe it won't work for anybody else. But if you're tired of being the guy who's always got to go into options every time someone hands you a controller, 100 hours of trackpad lunacy worked for me. And here's a section about how I grew up as a keyboard mouse guy, but I've come to enjoy using controllers. That part should have been cut. I'm not reading that part. Sound sensitivity. My sensitivity to sound is pretty severe. I think it might border on misophonia, which is a thing I learned about by self-diagnosing myself on the internet, but it's where people go nuts when they hear repetitive sounds, and I don't have it the way clinical people have it, but man, it makes a lot of sense. Like, I sleep with earplugs in every night, and I hated living in New York City. I fucking hated it, like, beyond reason, almost. And I think that's a big part of it, is that the noise there never stops, and it's just filthy, noisy, garbage city. So, I don't like it when cutscenes in games have their own volume setting, which doesn't take into account the audio options that I've chosen. I've got everything nice and balanced so that playing a game doesn't seem like a knitting needle stabbing me in the ear, and then the pre-mixed cutscene audio just has me diving for the TV remote. 'Tis unacceptable! Every game seems to overlook some weird setting or another. In general, I think designers can only be as detail-oriented as their biology will allow them to be. For years, it never occurred to designers that their games were hard for colorblind people to play until a colorblind person pointed that out. Similarly, I really think every audio department should employ a person who has abnormal sound sensitivity. They could point out some things, like how plate armor in Dark Souls doesn't have to clink loudly with every step. For me, it's like certain armor sets have an added stat requirement called turning the sound off. A relatively famous example would be how every guard in Skyrim talks about having taken a fucking arrow to the knee. They had half a dozen different actors all record that same line, and it's baffling. It's like they wanted people to turn the sound off. Arrow to the knee was bad enough for everyone to notice, but to we sound-obsessed weirdos, a lot of games seem similarly exasperating. If characters are going to say the same lines over and over, it'd be much better just to have them say nothing at all. Silence in a game world takes a long time before it seems out of place, whereas hearing the same dialogue twice in succession brings the whole simulation down immediately. I get into that idea a little more later in the book. I'm not quite sure why I felt the need to bring that up here in the introduction, but I did, so. Languages. There's an option to set the audio to French. I went to a French elementary school, but I never use my French. I should try this sometime. This is like my diary. If you ever play Heavy Rain, play it in French. Even if you have to rely on the subtitles, it's still incredibly better. Sadly, playing half of Heavy Rain is about the only time I've used my bilingualism in my adult life. I'm sorry, France, we just didn't love each other hard enough. A lot of jokes in this book that, I mean, aren't really jokes. I don't know, they're mildly entertaining turns of phrase, maybe? I don't know. In the bonus cinematics menu, each cinema has a watercolor style thumbnail. I've never noticed them before now. They look real nice. And this is why it's valuable to go through every single option in an option menu. Maybe you'll find cool thumbnails. That is one thing I really enjoyed about writing a whole book about one video game. There's still lots of little things that I missed, like when you look up those videos on YouTube of like, here's 8,000 things you didn't notice about The Last of Us. There's absolutely stuff in there that I didn't notice, but it is really fun to fine-tooth comb your way through a game you really like. It really just gives you an excuse to to go through every single menu, to dig through every little corner of all the little buildings and whatever. Stats. Let's look at some of my statistics after three playthroughs. Total kills, 1,630. Total melee kills, 975. Total deaths, 231. Accuracy, a mere 74%. Kills while holding a human shield, 0. Molotovs crafted, 0. And brick or bottle hits, 311. Bricks. As I learned more about the combat system, it became clear that bricks and bottles are like nuclear bombs. After you hit your opponent with one of those, they are totally helpless. It's the auto-targeting that really makes them effective. I'm gonna miss having them during this playthrough. I do remember one time I was babysitting for my friend Joel, who did the cover for this book, and I was just playing The Last of Us at his house, waiting for him to come back home. And I remember when he came back, he was watching me play for a couple of minutes, and it's just a simple thing, but I did the little thing where you let the auto-target target and threw a bottle at somebody. Which that alone is something a lot of people didn't seem to catch on to with The Last of Us. They, hand-targeted all their throws. But then I ran over and whacked the guy with a steel pipe. And because he was stunned from the bottle, like, that's it, he just died. And Joel was like, whoa, like, I didn't know you could do that. That's cool. And that's one of those things I'll get into more as the book goes on, but I really love how, despite the fact that the combat system in The Last of Us, it's quite simple, but there's so many ways you can have things interact and cool little aspects like that that are just neat. Crafting Molotovs. The fact that I crafted zero Molotovs is telling. The notion of Molotovs and health kits requiring the same components to craft is interesting. Should a player choose to create an offensive item or a defensive one? But having started my first playthrough on hard difficulty, the decision was essentially made for me. I needed health kits. I didn't have enough spare crafting items for the luxury of crafting Molotovs. I felt up against the wall all the time, so crafting Molotovs really never crossed my mind. Human shields. Kills while holding a human shield is something I wasn't aware of at all. I always like to turn off as many on-screen indicators as I can, and I love when games find ways to integrate that information directly into the game. Shout out to Dead Space, probably still the greatest in that sense. So I had turned off the on-screen combat prompts, and it wasn't until I watched someone else playing The Last of Us that I finally saw the triangle to grab a weakened opponent prompt. However, I suspect my kills while holding a human shield stat would still be at zero. Because why use a bullet when you can choke a man for free? My grandpa always said that. Funny guy. Bit of a murderer. Trophies. Here we get back into judgmental mode. Let's just cut to the chase. Nobody really cares what you do in life. You could be the President of the United States, pull down your pants in the middle of the United Nations, shit in your own hand, eat it, then do a backspin, and it'd only be in the news for a couple of months. Hoping that someone will be impressed by your PlayStation trophies is a pretty slim hope. It's like asking your mom to watch you jump from a diving board, except your mom might actually humor you. That being said, sometimes trophies do offer ideas for alternative strategies that can be fun to try. I'm not opposed to trophies per se. But as soon as gathering trophies turns into busy work, you owe it to yourself to fucking quit it. At least try to pretend that your goddamn life is worth something to you. On a conventional playthrough, very few trophies will pop. The trophies in The Last of Us can only be earned through deliberate busy work done during subsequent playthroughs. I can see how that might not be very fun for a trophy hunter, but I greatly appreciate that separation. Nothing interrupts the tone of a story more than receiving a goddamn trophy. On my first playthrough of The Last of Us, I don't think I heard that trophy noise once, and I don't think that was a failure of trophy design. I think that was a very deliberate choice, and I wholeheartedly applaud it. If someone wants to chase trophies, let them do it on their own time, during subsequent playthroughs. For someone who's trying to be immersed in the game's story, there is no need for trophy notifications to be jingling in the corner of the screen. The most egregious use of trophies. Shadow of the Colossus is a game where atmosphere is key to its minimalist storytelling. The initial excitement of bringing down enormous creatures gives way to a creeping unease. Where it's presumed that the player character is, by default, the hero, the reality of seeing these creatures systematically slaughtered becomes hard to ignore. In the PlayStation 3 re-release of Shadow of the Colossus, after each Colossus is killed, a bright little trophy notification appears. What the shit fuck? Talk about losing tone control. Know your place, trophies. If you're interfering with the experience to that degree, then you've got to go. I am aware that trophy notifications can be turned off, and after killing that first Colossus, you can be damn sure that's what I did. But if you want to talk an atrocious trophy list, Shadow of the Colossus is the champ. New Game Plus. New Game Plus seems pretty pointless in The Last of Us. It carries over all of your previous upgrades, making the game easier to beat rather than harder. It's kind of a strange decision. I expected more of a Dark Souls-style difficulty ramp. If I wanted the game to be easier, I would have set the game to an easier difficulty. So in a sense, my super apocalypse idea of not picking up any items is a self-made form of New Game Plus. Alright, that covers the options menu, so let's start this bad boy up. Loading spores. Even the loading screen, a burst of spores drifting across the screen. That's bad writing. Let's just use the word screen twice. Let's try to rewrite this on the fly. How else could I put this? Even the loading screen, a burst of spores drifting across a black field, is pretty beautiful. God damn it, I love this game. I initially didn't realize that these languid spores were even a loading screen. After seeing that weird window pane title screen, I thought maybe the spores were just another artsy visual. I would have been okay with that. I think there's an argument to be made for enforced contemplation time in games. Why not stare at some spores for a while? In a later update to the game, a little percentage loaded indicator appears at about 70%. I'm okay with that too. I guess the spores alone were a bit abstract. All right, we did it, we made it. That is all of my introductory remarks. The next segment is Prologue Texas. As excited as I am to get back into The Last of Us's world, there is a part of me that always finds the opening a bit tough to get through. Not because the opening is bad, but because the opening's so good. Each of my playthroughs becomes a little more mechanical, trying to delve deeper into the game's systems. But I'm not able to jump right in. I've got to get through this opening, which is so goddamn sad, so goddamn beautiful. It's a very different experience from the rest of the game. And while going through the opening, the effectiveness of bricks during combat could not be further away from mattering. There's a part of me that wishes for a whole game that's like this opening. An interactive movie is not something I would normally ask for, but Naughty Dog handle it so well. As will come up many times in this book, there's no opinion I have about video games that Naughty Dog can't break. Part of why the Boston section can drag as the game first settles in has got to be because this opening is so good and is so tough to let go of. Troy motherfucking Baker. I'm immediately struck by how perfect Troy Baker is as Joel. It's the right role performed by the right guy. Troy also played Bioshock Infinite's Booker DeWitt, and I never cared about that guy at all. I didn't buy into him. I didn't believe in his struggle. None of his words resonated with me. We were told a lot about his troubled past and his alcoholism and his wartime, blah, 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 blah. But there was nothing about that character that really rang true. On the other hand, everything Joel says, I buy into. Every line is his best line. Joel seems like a real guy. The opening cinematic. One thing I love about The Last of Us is that every time I play, I notice something new. This time, I noticed the first line of the game, when Joel comes through his front door talking on the phone. Tommy, listen to me. He's the contractor, okay? I can't lose this job. I understand. Let's talk about this in the morning, okay? We'll talk about it in the morning. All right, good night. That's my Joel impression. It's not great. It's what I got. I never thought about that phone call too hard. I just took it as generalized banter about money problems. But looking at it again, it sounds like Joel's brother Tommy is trying to coerce Joel. Maybe Tommy caught the contractor up to something shady, and he wants Joel to back him up in confronting the guy. But Joel doesn't care about that. Joel just wants the job. That would be in line with what we see of their respective characters later on. Tommy wants to do the right thing, and Joel just wants to survive. Joel got home just before midnight, and Sarah gives him his birthday watch. Latchkey kids. Growing up in the 80s, it wasn't weird for my parents not to be home during the afternoon. I could just go off and do whatever I wanted without telling anybody. people who grew up in the 70s often have stories of being basically left completely to their own devices. Leaving kids home alone has become much less common, and by 2013 standards, Joel leaving his daughter alone in an empty house could be seen as a bit negligent. Maybe he relaxed his parenting and everything was fine. So he relaxed it a little more, and a little more. And after a while, coming home at midnight, it's just something that would happen. That actually makes me think of my mom told me some stories about my grandfather going into like the Legion Hall and, you know, just drinking with his friends and just leaving the kids in the car, which I guess that was like a pretty common thing to happen back in the 60s. So yeah, it's interesting. 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s, 2000s, 2010s, like parenthood really has clamped down a lot. Not necessarily a bad thing, just interesting. Or interesting to me. Whatever, don't qualify, don't explain. Fucking. The outbreak. Sarah falls asleep watching TV and Joel takes her to her bed. She awakens later that night to the sound of a phone ringing. Uncle Tommy? That's my Sarah impression. Even worse than my Joel impression. Dialect. I wonder how good the Southern dialect is in The Last of Us. It's not something that I can accurately gauge. To me, Firefly and Preacher sound authentic as fuck, but people from the South say they're clunky. I guess it's similar to when a Canadian makes an appearance on a TV show. It's not generally a very graceful portrayal. I don't know where Neil Druckmann is from, but he did go to Florida State, and Florida counts as the South to me. Having Troy Baker as the lead actor probably also helped, as he is from Texas. There's nothing like having a native around to smooth out some cliches and to keep the dialogue generally grounded. Incidentally, I would like to reiterate that no one should ever, ever play Heavy Rain in English. Always play it in French with the subtitles. In fact, most games are just better played with only subtitles. Just because some awful voices have been supplied doesn't mean that you've got to accept them and let them ruin an otherwise perfectly presentable video game. I'm looking at you, guy who misdelivers every sentence out of Guybrush Threepwood's mouth. And I do realize the irony of complaining about voice actors when I'm ineptly trying to record my own thing, but I'm not a professional, I'm just some dick. Playing as Sarah. On Sarah's wall is the photo from her soccer game, which will later resurface at Tommy's power plant. There's a baseball bat next to her nightstand. Sarah is definitely a tomboy. I love the Dawn of the Wolf posters that show up everywhere. If the world ends, that is how it'll be. Whatever dumb movie was out at the time will be what you see everywhere. It's similar to watching footage from September 11th, 2001, and always seeing posters for Zoolander. That stupid fucking movie has been frozen in history. One of Sarah's stickers says Adjacent Hazard, which is not a very good band name. They don't sound like they rock. And while I'm examining Sarah's walls, she stretches and yawns and rubs her eyes in a way that looks pretty convincing. We've come a long way from Sonic tapping his foot, not that that wasn't super edgy and awesome. That is something, I mean, computer graphics and CG shit, it really has come a long way where, I mean, it was just death for a long time and I always preferred practical effects, say, to CG in movies. But I've been watching, like, those Planet of the Apes movies, and it's like, holy shit, these apes look good. Like, I'm buying into this. This is good shit. Or the Jungle Book movie that came out a couple of years ago. I remember it kind of blew my mind a little bit when I found out that that whole thing was just filmed on a tiny set and that the whole jungle was CG. I was like, holy shit, I didn't even realize. It didn't even cross my mind. Stuff is getting kind of good. Looking around Sarah's room reminds me of the Fulbright Company's Gone Home. The rooms in Joel and Sarah's house definitely tell a story. Someone took the time to design all of these posters, and most people probably never looked at them too closely. I definitely hadn't on my previous playthrough. And this is one of the fun aspects of writing about a game. It's an excuse to stop and to really look at all the little details. Joel and Ellie's last names. Sarah has an achievement certificate with a ribbon, and the ribbon covers up her last name. Apparently, the Japanese manual lists the characters' names as Joel Miller and Ellie Williams. Naughty Dog confirmed that those were their early names, but that officially, Joel, Sarah, and Ellie are single-named characters. I do kind of like it better that way. Something about the name Ellie Williams feels oddly generic in a way that a first name alone doesn't. The dark hallway. Leaving Sarah's room and walking through the empty house definitely evokes the feeling of being a kid at night. If anything, it should probably be even darker. As a kid, I could navigate my whole house in the dark, but the journey to find a light switch always felt pretty freaky. The newspaper in the bathroom says September 26. Assuming it's from that morning, September 26 must be Joel's birthday. There are a couple of unaccounted for people in the photographs around the house. There's a guy I don't recognize, and some girls around Sarah's age, but there are no pictures of a wife. She's probably been gone a while, and I'm guessing she left Joel rather than having died. Had she died, there would probably be pictures. Joel's opening phone conversation with Tommy suggests that he's financially flailing. But on a side table in the hall, there's a book that reads, "Everything You Need to Know About Creating a Startup." So Joel may have had some bigger plans. Joel's room. There's light coming from Joel's room, and Sarah heads in. The news report on the TV shows chaos happening in the city, and there's a sudden explosion in the distance that's visible outside the window. The press L3 to look at something noteworthy mechanic rears its head. This pressing L3 function doesn't always work for me. I'm often busy looking at something else, and by the time I press L3, it's a second too late to see what the game is trying to show me. In some situations, maybe pulling camera control from the player would have been better. If there was an explosion outside the window, for example, my character's head would naturally whip toward it. I think losing camera control would probably feel all right. The same book about creating a startup is also in Joel's room. Don't buy multiple copies of books, Joel. Every dollar counts. This is great. It's like, I don't want to go into the hallway to get my other copy of the book. If I'm in my room, I read the book in my room. If I'm in the hallway, I read the copy in the hallway. Holy shit. There's a cloud here that looks like a fucking horse. Let me take a picture of that. There, on the YouTube version, you can have a blurry picture of a fucking horse cloud. Oh, this is fucking weird that I just fucking saw a horse cloud. Because what's up with the painting of wild stallions in Joel's room? I guess he knows what he likes? No one's gonna keep you down, Joel. Don't worry, you'll be wild and free. Forever. Heading downstairs. After the explosion outside, Sarah's body language changes. She seems much more on edge. If this were Indigo Prophecy, she could play the guitar that's downstairs to regain some composure. But without that mechanic, she remains stressed. Wasn't that cool? I mean, I remember with Indigo Prophecy, it's called Fahrenheit in Europe. It was the first David Cage game I ever played, and I never heard of the guy. Just my cousin had it, and he's like, check out this game, it's really cool. And I really liked that idea that you would get stressed and you could do things to remove your stress, but they ended up taking that mechanic out of Heavy Rain in the later games because it just was weird. Like, I remember this one part where you were in, like, the basement of a police station, and you just had to find a case file. And for whatever reason, that very slightly stressed out your character. And if you waited long enough, if you just, like, refused to find the case file, like, I'm just not gonna find it, your character would eventually become so stressed that they would go crazy, just because they're in a basement full of files. Like, yeah, it was a cool idea, but it didn't work. And the startup book is on the downstairs coffee table as well. I felt like a big detective when I first spied that book in the hallway. But now I'm realizing that Joel's house is not intended for this level of scrutiny. Though to be fair, the Gone Home house also had way too many empty binders. So nobody's perfect. This house is surprisingly house. See, I mentioned earlier about the inelegant representation of Canadians on TV. Because, you know, the aboot thing. It's fucking absurd. No one says fucking aboot. But we do have an accent, and that's it. House. The house. This house is surprisingly lo-fi for 2013. There's a CD with a tape deck and a VCR. It really is like the Gone Home house. Though I did have a VCR in my old apartment because sometimes you just need a VCR if you want to watch some weird old shit. Maybe Joel wants to watch I Was a Teenage Werewolf, but it was never released on DVD. He and Sarah aren't so different with their love of werewolves that I just made up. There's a picture of Joel and Sarah as a toddler, still no wife to be seen. So she must have left very early on. Okay, you ready for the cleverest segment title in this whole book? There's a shit ton of segments in this book, but this is my favorite title. Apocalypse Now! So pleased with myself. Joel comes barging into the house, followed by goddamn zombie Jimmy Cooper, who won't fuck off, causing Joel to shoot the crazy bastard. The apocalypse is officially underway. Joel and Sarah run out of the front of the house where Tommy's waiting, and they all climb into his SUV. Joel's neighbor two doors down is packing up a hatchback, but nobody talks to him. Maybe he was a jerk. Just another fucking Jimmy Cooper. Whole neighborhood of Jimmy Coopers. Riding in the back seat. See, that's not clever at all. That's just what's happening. They can't all be clever. Sarah observing from the SUV's back seat is genius. Looking around at what's going on, listening to the adults talking, it really harkens back to what it felt like to be a kid. Crazy shit's happening, nobody's really letting you in on what it is. You're hoping the adults will take care of things, but it's clear they don't fucking know what they're doing either. The montage from the start of 2004's Dawn of the Dead was my previous favorite apocalypse simulation, but The Last of Us gives it a run for its money. A family on the roadside tries to flag down Joel and Tommy, and it's been said that Joel's insistence on ignoring them speaks to his ignoble character and the cruelties he will later be capable of. But I'd say it takes some wind out of his decision to see that there's a traffic jam just up the road. That family only needs to walk over a bridge, and they'll be as far as Joel could have taken them. So stop being so hard on Joel, everyone. Come on. Of all the shitty things Joel's gonna do, so he didn't pick up these people. Who gives a shit? Crash! Should I just do that now? Should I yell every segment title? Houses are on fire, people are freaking out. And as we approach a more populated area, a car suddenly slams into the side of Tommy's vehicle. Bam! Fuck! Sarah's leg is hurt, and we now take control of Joel, climbing from the overturned SUV and getting attacked by an infected dickhead. Tommy comes to the rescue, introducing us to the secretly most powerful weapon in the game, the brick. Nothing can stop a brick, except a bloater or a flailing clicker. But still, bricks are real good. Joel carries Sarah, and we get to running. Setting paths. Designing a path for a player to follow must be a tough job. The first time I played The Last of Us, I realized immediately to go down an alleyway, but I went too soon. I had to wait for Tommy to direct me to a place where I already was. But watching other people play, the path is not always so evident. They're running into fires, they're barreling headlong into throngs of zombies. A game designer's life... This is an odd sentence. A game designer's life must be filled with a lot of tongue-biting concerning the common sense levels of their fellow human beings. I don't like that sentence very much, but what I mean is it must be tough to design levels for people of varying observational skill. Valve, for example, are considered masters of directing players, but I got lost in every Half-Life game I ever played. I got so lost that I was just running around an empty level and hating my life. That happened quite a long way into Half-Life 1, but quite quickly in Half-Life 2. So no matter how good of a path you set, you gotta accept that a couple hundred thousand idiots are gonna misunderstand everything you arranged, quit your game, and question why everyone likes Half-Life 2 so much. And that was one of the letters I got about this book. The dude was like, hey buddy, I like your book, but you gotta get on that Half-Life 2 thing, man, you're missing out. So I will. Someday I'll go back to Half-Life 2. Sarah. Oh, this is the sad part. No more exuberant yelling. Okay, let's go quiet. Let's go real sad right now. On their way out of the city, a soldier who was ordered to hold the perimeter fires at Joel and Sarah. Sarah doesn't make it. I apologize for the curt retelling, but there's really nothing I can say to do justice to how heart-wrenching this scene is. Characters dying in video games has been a mainstay since Final Fantasy II on the SNES. But this is definitely one of the rougher ones. I feel like I just betrayed my Canadian heritage a little by calling it the SNES. We always called it the NES and the SNES, or possibly the Super NES. Sorry to rubber band back so quickly, but I mean, you know how sad the Sarah thing is. Jesus Christ, what am I supposed to say? It's like the saddest video game thing since, like, Fatopia. It's fucking sad, man. We all know it's sad. Sensitivity. As I said before, I think a person's particular sensitivities can often dictate what level of care they can achieve with their art. If you can't envision a particular artistic goal, particularly a complex one, you're not going to stumble upon it by accident. Acting in video games is one such example. It's usually bad, but not purposefully so. Some producers didn't hire the male Shepard as a joke. They hired him because they didn't know how bad he is. The video game industry is filled with tin ears. Obviously, this stuff is all relative. I clearly think I've got a good enough ear to mock and belittle the decisions of others, despite having no experience in the field. But Neil Druckmann's sensitivity in such matters is much more quantifiable. There's a story in Grounded: The Making of The Last of Us, which is a documentary Area 5 made about The Last of Us, which is really cool, about the multitude of retakes that the team did while recording Sarah's death scene. Troy Baker said he was sure he had nailed the scene. He was sobbing, having a breakdown, and delivering what he considered some of the best acting of his career. Had I been in charge, I'm sure I would have stopped there. Any of us would have. In a scene about a dying kid, a big emotional performance seems appropriate. But Druckmann called the actors back, and he had Troy play the scene again, giving a quieter performance. The earlier takes didn't feel perfect to him, so he didn't stop there. He went back, and that story impresses the hell out of me. Despite everyone's hard work, Druckmann felt that he needed a little more, and that eye for quality really does describe The Last of Us as a whole. But Druckmann's not some jerk director who's exerting his will and making everyone around him miserable. By all accounts, he's a real nice guy. As I get older, I'm starting to realize that talent, or lack thereof, is not necessarily the biggest roadblock to a project. Being able to collaborate without stepping on other people's toes is the truly difficult task. Guys like Neil Druckmann, who have a very clear vision, but who can also successfully lead a team to achieve that vision, that seems admirable. Sarah's death also sets the tone for all of The Last of Us' storytelling. It demonstrates that the emotional beats will be appropriate to the character, even if that means a reaction being smaller than might be expected. a quieter performance can sometimes carry a larger impact. And that philosophy carries all the way through to the final scene. All right, so we're finally at the opening credits, signified by a segment I have titled Opening Credits. The music in this game is so good. I know that's not a very insightful comment, but come on, man, it's fucking great. Musical sparseness and the road. Finding a subtle score in any kind of work is hard. I've mentioned how sound bothers me very easily, but in The Last of Us, the music never grates. The Last of Us is compared often to The Road, and The Road is a good example of how movies can really distill the weaknesses in a story. In a novel, details about the larger world are easy for the reader to fill in themselves. But having the literal nuts and bolts of the story laid out visually causes its unreality to become very apparent. The road in film, it's like a cartoon apocalypse. It's so bleak, it feels like two characters walking through a metaphor rather than inhabiting a real world. Yet, despite the incredible sparseness of the visuals, the filmmakers could not cool out with the music. The man and his son hear sounds in the distance, they hide, tension mounts. Then a gang of raiders crest the hill to an enormous swell of music. We're a pretty media-savvy generation, and musical swells like that practically offend me. It feels like my grandpa's tapping me on the shoulder and saying, "Now see, son? This here situation? It's scary. Those men are probably dangerous. That fella and his son? They're real nervous. They're nervous about seeing them other men." I know, Grandpa. I'm just in the woods yelling to myself right now. I know, Grandpa. Will you get out of here? Stop trying to tell me what's going on through the medium of a bombastic film score. What is this, Lawrence of fucking Arabia? They're in an apocalypse. It's scary. I get it. Then Grandpa starts crying at my outburst. And I don't mean to make an old man cry, but this shit has gotta stop. In The Last of Us, this shit has totally stopped. It's surprising to listen to the soundtrack and to realize how few immediately recognizable tracks there are. The whole thing is pretty sparse and is very carefully integrated. And when the music does swell up, it always complements the situation and never smothers it. Actually, at the time I wrote this, I saw the movie of The Road, but I hadn't read the book yet. And that's it's a whole other topic, but the book's real good. It's way better than the movie. I mean, it's far overrated. The fact that it won a Pulitzer is fucking absurd. But it's just like an adventure book about the apocalypse. The Road's pretty cool. And now that I've read the book, man, that movie really is boneheaded. Like, man, they did a dumb job. But that's, at the very least, they could have just taken out that music and it would have helped so much. Film scores, man, they're so boring and so generic. God bless The Last of Us. God bless you, Gustavo. You fucking rock. Video game music. In the 8-bit era, I really loved video game music. The limitations of technology led to some really amazing stuff. A composer's task was to create short music loops that could be listened to for long periods, and when they pulled it off, they really knocked it out of the park. In the 16-bit era, there's still a lot of classic tunes, but the increased complexity makes those songs stick less in my mind. And from then on, the whole paradigm shifted. With CD audio, video game music just became music. It became generic, something that usually faded into the background. Video game music is now more about tone than specific melody, and in that sense, The Last of Us's sparse implementation really works well. The introduction of the Fireflies. The references to the Fireflies in these opening credits always felt a bit ham-fisted to me. On a micro-story level, a young girl has just died in front of us. On a macro-level, the world is entirely collapsing. At neither of those levels does some dorky group called the Fireflies feel relevant in the slightest. Their introduction does not feel very organic, and seems much more like a plot contrivance being foisted upon the player. I heard that these opening credits were a later addition to The Last of Us. In earlier versions, the story cut directly from Sarah's death straight to 20 years later in Boston. Players found it jarring, so the credit sequence was added. And I do like it. It's very visually beautiful, and having some downtime after Sarah's death is a good idea. I can see where the impulse came from to plant some seeds about the Fireflies within these credits, but it might have been better to focus on the apocalypse itself. Let the Fireflies be revealed once we're more firmly entrenched in the story. Fucking Fireflies. I always felt vaguely opposed to the Fireflies right from the start. Their public charter calls for the return of all branches of government. Like, get the fuck out of here, Fireflies. Bunch of wankers. I don't know why I chose wankers.
Bunch of bleeding wankers. These Fireflies are bleeding wankers.
Whenever Joel gives the Fireflies a sarcastic rebuke or a light stabbing, I tend to be on his side. Incidentally, who is giving the news reports during these opening credits? In a world where most branches of government have dissolved, what kind of lunatic is still broadcasting in an old-world phony baloney newscaster voice? There is, though, a really cool bonus feature on the 2004 Dawn of the Dead DVD, or I guess Blu-ray nowadays, where there's this really simple little bonus feature they made, really inexpensive, but it was kind of that. It was just a guy holed up during the breakdown of society, and he's just filming his day-to-day updates on what's going on. I haven't seen it in a long time, but I remember that being really cool. All right, you know what? I thought we were going to get a little bit into Boston, but I think that's enough. That's enough for this episode. So, we will get to 20 years later in Boston. I hope you're enjoying this audio version of the book, The Last of Us Surviving the Super Apocalypse, which I will reiterate is available at keithcourage.com or on Amazon. If you're entertained by this stupid shit, please let someone know, and that would be awesome. I will see you next time for some walking around Boston, some meeting Tess, some fucking gun running with Robert. Basically, the weakest part of the whole game. let's get into that. That is totally the feeling I had the first time I played The Last of Us, was like this beginning part is so fucking crazy good. Just like one of the greatest opening sequences in a video game that there will ever be. So fucking good. And then to just be like, oh great, now I just need to pretend I care about running guns from Robert. Fucking Robert. And I mean, the game picked up again real quick, but I totally felt that pressure of just like, we've lost the cabin pressure. Just like, what am I doing now? Who cares about this? But we'll get into that next time. Thank you for listening, and adios.